Says all scripture is given by inspiration of God. You know this passage. All scripture, how much scripture? All scripture is given by inspiration of God. It means it's God-breathed. It means that God is the source of the scriptures. Even though men wrote it, it is God-breathed. So, for instance, if you imagine a boat sailing along the water, a sailboat, and it's carried by the wind in the sails. God-breathed means that the scriptures were ushered by the very breath of God. All scripture is God-breathed and is profitable. Now, listen here. The scripture is profitable. There are multiple benefits in the scripture for obeying, for reading, for studying, for growing in the word of God. There are built-in profits or benefits. The scripture, all scripture is profitable for what? For doctrine, for reproof, for correction, and for instruction in righteousness. Notice the benefit of scripture. No matter how long you've been in Jesus, no matter how far and wide you've traveled, no matter your gift, no matter the maturity level, no matter your success rate, one of the things you will not be able to escape as a child of God is a need for the scripture. A need for the word of God in your spirit. A need for the digestive process, the internalization of the word. Amen? And so the word, the scripture is profitable. It's beneficial for doctrine, for reproof, for correction and instruction in righteousness. Why? That the man or the woman of God may be perfect or mature. Now, what is mature? Thoroughly furnished unto all good work. Has anybody here ever built or bought a house and you was too broke to put furniture in it? Don't be ashamed. Amen. You don't have to raise your hand if you don't want to. It's a rhetorical question. However, now, I'm not knocking it. When we built our house, people told us that it's going to take us 5 years to furnish it. And I thought about that. And I said, well, I ain't doing that. I am not sitting on the floor for no 5 years. So I came up with a way to get the furniture prior to and have it ready when the house was built. Now, amen. But the point of the matter is, if you go into an apartment or a house without furnishings, it's uncomfortable. It's dysfunctional. You don't cook all that food, where you gonna eat it? You gotta sit down. Your legs have to be in shape because you're gonna cross them and sit on the floor. Come on now, you invite company over, everybody squatting on the floor, and it happens all the time. You know, usually we get some beanie pillows or something to try to make it comfortable. But what you have is a situation that's not furnished. The word of God is designed to furnish you, to provide the capacity for full usage in every compartment or room of your life. The word of God is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction and instruction in righteousness. Now, go to Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12. The emphasis that I want to apply today is correction. We're talking about joy, but I want to show you joy from the position of correction. First of all, remember the Father loves you. So what does the Bible say? Verse 6, for whom the Lord loves, he does what? He chastens. Anybody have a translation that's other than the King James? He disciplines. He corrects. All right? So correction is an ingredient of relationship. So whom the Father loves, he corrects. He chastens and scourges every son whom he receives. Now, let me get this straight, y'all. There is joy on the other side of correction. Amen. Amen. Now, I really want you to understand that we live in a day when people want joy, blessings, and good things and great things, and I think that's a part of the Christian journey, but the problem is we often are willing to sell out. And we want to treat, like, if you listen to the televangelists, you will believe that you are anointed for everything and responsible for nothing. Oh, I wish I could talk to you. The anointing is not some sort of escape clause from responsibility. Matter of fact, the greater your anointing, the greater the level of responsibility you're going to bear on your shoulders. Now watch what the Bible says. Whom he loves, he chastens. Isn't that what it says? I'll give it to you in another way. In the Gospel of John, he says that the tree that does not, or the branch that does not bear fruit, what does he do? He cut it off. He throws it away. But the branch that bears fruit, what does he do? He prunes that baby. In other words, I'm doing good, Lord. Why are you cutting me? I don't want to be cut. I'm doing good. Seemed to me like I shouldn't be cut. But the Bible says that it may bear more fruit. Now listen to me. Responsibility or anointing or selection, when God chooses you, he anoints you. When he selects you, he appoints you, he gives you, he gives you power. Now, part of that process or purpose is for you to bear fruit. And in order for you to bear fruit and not get complacent, he'll trim you. He will cut you where you did not ask to be cut. I told you, you should have celebrated earlier. You should have shouted earlier. Because we're going in a different direction now. We're still talking about joy, but I'm going to prove it to you. Look at, stay in chapter 12, look at verse 11. Now, no chastising, no chastening, no punishment, no correction, no discipline for the present seems what? Now listen, come on now, don't front, don't get funny on me. You, how many parents in the room? How many times you been whooping your child or disciplining your child and your child said, oh, you finished? Give me about four more strikes. If you whack me three more times, I'll really get the message, Mom. How many times have your kids said, my punishment's over? Can you give me another week? If you give me one more week, the lesson will really stick in. You don't hear that. Ain't nobody talking like that. Because chastening or correction is not pleasant. Well, can I give you a heads up? We are entering into a season of correction. As a church, from top to bottom, from the head all the way through. That means me and you. We need to do some internal assessment. Now, internal assessment means correction. Amen. Now listen to me, you do not want to be a believer and convince yourself that you don't need no correction, because you're on dangerous ground. You are on a slippery slope. Everybody needs some correction, some instruction, some tweaking, amen, some pruning. All right? So we are headed into a place, a season of correction. And what I mean by that is ministry leaders, Christians, individuals, top to bottom, pulpit to the door, everybody, I want us to step into a season where we assess ourselves. When we open ourselves up to some critique. Anybody here have difficulty sitting down, listening to somebody tell you what's wrong with you? Oh, that's a hard amen right there. That's hard to say amen to that. Because don't nobody like being told, who you talking to? What about you? Right? You know when they say something about you, the first thing you say is, well, what do you do to say? Well, you do it. Yeah, but that ain't the issue. We talking about you right now. Yeah, well, why don't we talk about you? Well, can we finish talking about you first? And then we can talk about, yes, let's talk about me. But you using all your trickery and energy to stop us from dealing with you. Where does that come from? I'm gonna show you. The text says it's not joyous, but watch this. There's no chastening for the present seems to be joyous, but grievous. It's grievous. Don't feel good, right? It does not feel good. It seems to be joyous, but it's grievous. Nevertheless, afterward, watch that. Afterward, what does it do? It yields the peaceable fruit of righteousness. Now watch this. After you get correction and you embrace it, after you get a reproof and you embrace it, it produces righteousness, which says that if you get a reproof or a correction and you reject it, what does it produce? Unrighteousness. Now follow me. We're going to take a look at I want to start at the top, all right? I'm including me in this season of correction, right? So let's start at the top. Does God correct his leaders? Yes, he does. Yes, he does. Is God a respecter of persons? No. Does God fear the people he appointed? God ain't scared of you. He ain't scared of me. Right? God says stuff like, I talk with Moses face to face. Moses is my prophet. There's none another prophet like unto Moses. But yet when Moses messed around, got an attitude, disobeyed God, hit that rock, what did God tell him? You can't go in the promised land. Wait a minute. Whoa. All these 40 years, all these years I've been fighting and fussing with these people and leading. And I didn't even want to do this in the first place. I was fine on the backside of the desert with my family. You called me to go back to Egypt, which I was scared of. And then the people rejected me. I obeyed you. We out of Egypt. And they just got on my nerves. And all I did was hit the rock. Yeah, well, I love you, Moses, but you can't go in. David, man after God's own heart. Man after God's own heart. David commits adultery. God says, the sword shall not depart from your house. Well, what does that mean, God? What does that mean? Because I'm a man of the sword. I'm a warrior. I'm a soldier. That sounds like something I can handle. It's just me rumbling. No, I didn't say the sword's not going to depart from the battlefield. I said the sword's not going to depart from your house. So what are you talking about? Well, your consequences look like this. One of your sons is going to rape one of your daughters, and your other son is going to kill the son that raped the daughter, and then you're going to have a son that rebels against you and tries to pull a coup in your kingdom and take over at the city gate, because the consequences of your sin are going to be in your house. And David, although I love you and I appointed you and I favored you and I gave you everything you ever asked for and would have gave you more had you asked, I want you to understand, I'm not intimidated by you. Oh, I think you don't get it. See, sometimes we get too comfortable or too blessed or too accustomed to our favor that God has given us, and we start to assume. Oh, come on here. Now, listen. Now, watch this. The Bible says in this passage, it doesn't last for long, but when it happens, it yields the fruit of righteousness unto them which are exercised thereby. What does that mean, exercised thereby? Do you know that discipline is, you can't have exercise without discipline? You know how you walk up the steps and try to lie to yourself and say you worked out? The reason that didn't work is because it was absent discipline. Yeah. Discipline will exercise you. Chastisement, punishment, going through trials. Watch what James says. My brethren, count it all. When? On a good day? No. When you enter into diverse trials and tests. What? Yes. Count it all joy. Why? Because when it's done, what it produces in you is righteousness. All right, stay with me. I'm not going to keep you long. Now, let's go to where I want to live today. Go to 1 Samuel, chapter 15 and 16. All right, let's take a look at this cat, Saul. Let's just take a look at Saul. Now, I've told you I want to start at the top. I want to show you the process of chastisement, and this particular case is one whereby the one being chastised refuses to conform. Now, to see how we got there or where we're going with this, I want to show you chapter 16. Stay in the same book, 1 Samuel, and look at chapter 16. All right, verse 1. The Bible says in verse 1 of chapter 16, and the Lord said to Samuel, watch this, how long will you mourn for Saul, seeing I have rejected him from reigning over Israel? Did you catch that? Notice God's conversation with Samuel. Now, he says to Samuel? How long? How long you going to grieve over this man? I've rejected him. Now, go get the oil and get on your way. I want you to see the contrast here. Why is Samuel grieving over Saul? Because he anointed him. Now, listen to me, y'all. Listen to me, leaders, prophets, teachers, elders, overseers, those who run organizations. Watch this middle ground. Samuel's still grieving over Saul. God says, stop. Stop. But I anointed him. I'm responsible for him. I gave him what I had. I believed in him. I invested in him. Yes, you did. And all of that's legit. However, despite your intercession on his behalf, I have rejected him. Now, it doesn't matter how long you stay on your knees all night long. It doesn't matter what verses you quote, Samuel. I have cut him off. Now, get up, get the oil, and let's get busy with my program. Whoa. Let me show you who you don't want to be in this passage, Saul. Now, being Samuel ain't so bad. But I want you to understand that when you train people and invest in people, sometimes you got to learn when to let it go. You and I own nobody. God owns everybody. It's no different than with a parent and a child. There's a time you got to cut them loose. I know the world's hard and it's rough out there, and you wonder if they're going to make it, and you're concerned about them, and you're going to weep in the night, and that's legitimate. If you notice, you don't love nobody like you love your children, and it seems like God designed that into the fabric of humanity because our hard hearts enable us to hate people to levels that are amazing, so he gives us people that come out of us, and as a result, we have an unconditional love for them even when they act a pure D fool, and that's a beautiful thing that God has done. But in spite of your love for them, what God has said is you don't own them, and you had a time to train them, and now you're responsible to let them go. Oh, I wish I could talk to you. And if you don't let them go, you'll find yourself in opposition to my plan. Then both of y'all be in opposition. Oh, I wish I could talk to you. Now look. All right, here we go. He says, I told you, get up. Go, and I will send you to Jesse. Now, I want to put you and me in Saul's place, and Saul is being replaced. God says, go, I'm going to send you to Jesse, for I have provided me a king among the sons. Can I say this? When I first started pastoring, or back when I was thinking about pastoring, and I realized that might be a direction my life was going in, I started thinking about the variables that would matter to me or that would fit my design, or how should I best serve God as a pastor. And I began to ask God. I said, now it's up to you. I can't tell you what to do, but I'm asking you not to put me in any rural church where the population is only 75 people. You know why? Because in a small situation, the people don't have to change. Because there's no threat of somebody else taking their job. See, God will replace you. God will replace me. There's something about knowing that there's somebody else who can do it just as good. That makes you do it a little better, or it makes you stay your course. See, if you find yourself in a small place where people don't have to change, they don't have to deal with nothing, and if you try to change them, they just get rid of you and keep on with the same routine, that can be a defeating situation. But if you're somewhere where you got to stay sharp because the competition is tall, and you got to be on your best, and you got to be flexible, and you got to be moving forward, this is productive. In the case here, Saul took some things for granted, and before he knows what's happening, God done switched the playing field. Samuel, go do what I told you to do. Why are we in this situation? Come on with me with this passage, and I'm going to get you out of here. All right? Look back to chapter 15, all right? Let's chime in. If I had the video, I would have showed you. There's a movie. It's called King David. Richard Gere played the part of King David. It was a great movie. It's really close to the scriptures, but it didn't get a lot of play, and many people don't know about it. But there's a scene I wanted to show you, but I can't show it to you because we couldn't hook up the iPod, so I'm going to show it to you in the text. The Bible says in verse 8. Well, look at verse 7. And Saul smote 1 Samuel 15, verse 7. And Saul smote the Amalekites from Havilah until you come to Shur, that is over against Egypt. And he took Agag, the king of the Amalekites, alive, and he utterly destroyed all the people with the edge of the sword. But Saul, watch this, and the people Saul and the people. Saul and, is that what that text says? Saul and the people spared Agag. They spared the best of the sheep, the best of the oxen, the best of the fatlings, and the lambs, and all that was good. Did you catch that? But everything else, they would not utterly destroy those things, but everything that was vile, everything that was refuse, that they destroyed. Did you catch that? Don't miss that detail right there. All right? Now, the Bible says, here's the deal. Saul was supposed to be doing what God told him to do. And so what Saul did was, he took Agag captive, and the Bible says Saul and the people spared Agag, and they spared the best stuff. But the worst stuff they destroyed. Now follow me, stay with me, because what emerges from the text is the conflict that you may run into from time to time, particularly after God has blessed you and anointed you, of greed versus obedience. Oh, now watch. The text says, but Saul and the people spared Agag. Now, keep going. Verse 10, then came the word of the Lord to Samuel. What? How come God didn't show up to Saul and confront him? Listen to me, y'all. When you do not obey God, you trigger events that don't manifest right in front of you. Please follow this. When you disobey God, you trigger events that don't initiate in your presence. The Bible says, the word of the Lord went to Samuel, saying, watch what God said. He said, it repenteth me that I set up Saul to be king. Can I stop right there? You know, it's all right if other people say they don't like you. It's all right if other folk don't like your personality, don't like your presentation, they don't like your style, and they conclude that they just ain't gonna sit up under you or follow you or be a part of your stuff. That ain't so bad. But the Bible says, God said, it repents me. Do you know when I studied 1 and 2 Samuel, 1 and 2 Chronicles, 1 and 2 Kings. When I first got saved, I read through them. They were so active, so energetic, so much activity. I just read those books, and I fell in love with those books. And I didn't know at the time that I had a calling on my life. But those books made me afraid. Because here's a king, and God is saying, it repents me that I appointed you. Now, I want God to say a lot of stuff about me, but that ain't one of them. I don't want God thinking I'm a backup from off of you. I'm going to take the stuff I gave you back. It repents me that I anointed you. Did you see that? Now, watch the reasons. The reasons are very clear in the text. For he has turned back from following me, you can write this down, and he has not performed my commandments. There are two offenses that Saul committed. He turned back and he did not obey. Turn back and did not obey. Can I pause right here? Anybody turn back? Anybody done turn back to some stuff? Anybody wrestling with old appetites? Oh, come on now. Anybody thinking about turning back? Based on what God told you, but you're thinking about going in the other direction. I know life is hard, backing you in a corner, and it's trying you, but let me ask you a question. Have you been thinking about turning back? Can I just let you know that one of the things about becoming saved is that once you get on this path, you need to stay on this monster. You need to go ahead and finish what you started. You need to be consistent. You need to stop looking to the left and stop looking to the right and set your face like a flint and press toward the mark of the high prize of the calling. Because it's really better to not come to Christ than it is to come to Christ and start going wayward. Oh, I wish I could talk to you. He turned back. He turned back and he did not perform what God told him to do. I know this is elementary and basic, but I need you to get it, because when we get puffy, it's the elementary stuff and the basic stuff that we start forgetting. The Bible says that he turned back, and now watch this. The Bible says, and from my commandment, and it grieved Saul, and Saul cried unto the Lord all night. Remember, when you invest in somebody, and then the Lord had to teach me this as a pastor, you don't own anybody. And there are people you're going to invest in, and they're not going to do what you thought they were going to do with it, or they're not going to use it the way you thought they were going to use it. But you got to be careful how much power you give it over you. The reason you bless people is because God told you to. You shouldn't have any ulterior motive. You should not be tied to somebody because you don't know what their spirit is. You don't know what their long term is going to be. You don't know how they're going to do with what you gave them. You need to maintain a certain freedom. Now, believe me, it's a tight walk because you got to stay close enough to help them just in case they need help. But you need to be far enough so that when God wants to get in there, that you ain't in the way. The Bible says he grieved all night. Now, notice what God said. He didn't obey my commandments. What are the commandments? Just so that everybody's clear here, the command was in verse 3 of chapter 15. So if you look at verse 3, God said, now go smite the Amalekites. And the reason he's smiting the Amalekites is in verse 2 of the same chapter. The Amalekites laid in wait for Israel when they came out. And so God is now saying, Saul, I want you to go ahead and render vengeance. I want you to smite the Amalekite. Now watch what he says in verse 3. Utterly destroy all that they have. Spare them not. Notice how far God goes. But slay both man, woman, infant, suckling, ox, sheep, camels, donkeys. What does that sound like? Kill everything. A caution and a warning. When you get into new ventures with God, often he will test you up front to see if a smidgen of success wakes up your greed more than your obedience. Oh, I wish I could talk to you. You've got to learn to wear it loosely. There are always benefits that come with obeying God. But some benefits are a curse to your progression. In other words, you got to know how to say no to negative things, and you also got to know how to put a knife to your throat when it comes to certain benefits. I'm not saying don't have nothing. I'm just saying discern when to take your hands off of stuff. God says, I want you to take out everything. Now watch the discussion. So Saul grieves all night. And when Saul rose early in the morning to meet Samuel, or when Samuel rose to meet Saul in the morning, it was told Samuel, saying, Saul came to Carmel. And behold, he set up a place and has gone about and passed on and gone down to Gilgal. So now Samuel has to find Saul. So Samuel came to Saul, and Saul said unto him, watch this. Samuel walks in the room. Saul starts talking. Can I give you a basic principle? When it comes to the prophet or the scenario where you really need to listen, shut up first. Think about it. Quick to hear, slow to speak. Now that's mathematical. How many ears you got? How many mouths? Twice as much hearing? Soon as Samuel comes in the room, whenever the prophet arrived, that's why I wish I had that to show you. When the prophet showed up, there was usually a servant going before the prophet, and he was ringing a bell, and that gave everybody notice that the prophet was here. Matter of fact, when Saul came into town prior, you hear them ask, are you here peaceably? Because you don't know if the prophet came to do damage, or you don't know if the prophet came to give a blessing. And so Samuel comes, and Saul starts talking. Samuel said, Verse 13, blessed be thou of the Lord. I have performed the commandment of the Lord. What does Saul say? He says, I've did it. I did what I was supposed to do. Blessed be thou. First of all, you remember when Nicodemus came to Jesus? Talking about, thou art a man come from God, from the Father. We know thou art come from the Father, because nobody can do the miracles that Jesus. Shut up. You must be born again. Don't be trying to butter me up. Come on with the games. People give me that all the time. Oh, Bishop. Yeah. Let's get to it. Right? Oh, is it Bishop or is it Pastor? Don't even try it. What's up? Right? Don't come on now. Stop playing. Right? So he comes in there. Oh, thou from the Lord, I have obeyed. What's Saul's perspective of what he did? His interpretation of his own behavior is that he obeyed. Now watch this. He says, I've obeyed. And so Samuel said in verse 14, and see, Saul done stepped in it already. Well, what is this sound of sheep that I hear? We're on the battlefield. Why do I hear sheep? And the lowing of the ox. Why do I hear that if you obeyed God? Now watch Saul. They have brought them from the Amalekite. Who they? They. Now listen to me. When you choose to not obey God and you are a leader, you better be careful about this blame shifting stuff. As soon as Saul is challenged by Samuel, they. Before it was, oh, blessed of the Lord, I have obeyed God's word. Well, what is this sheep and ox that I hear? They. That's what he said. They have brought them from the Amalekites. For the people spared the best of the sheep and of the oxen to sacrifice unto the Lord your God. Well, you really messing up now. He ain't our God, he's my God, and it was the people's fault, and you trying to come forth as some innocent victim. And the rest we utterly destroyed. Then he gonna throw that term in there, utterly destroyed. See, now he knows that's the right term, but the reality is that's not what he did. Let me tell you something. When you gaming on God because you trying not to do what he said, you start trying to find ways to slip in stuff so that it sounds like you did what you were supposed to do, when in reality, you know you gaming. Now listen to me, y'all. Listen to me. I'm talking about top down. Top down. That includes me too. Top down. Here's the danger of success, believer. The danger of success is you start taking refuge in all your accoutrement. In other words, because I got a suit on and I got a microphone, I'm convincing no matter what. Not if you're living wrong in private. Because I got a throne and I got people around me that I can convince and sway an audience, all of a sudden, I'm starting to believe my own mess. So it's a lie under the skin, but I'm caught up in the way I look and the way things are going. And so therefore, I try to game on the prophet. Listen to the danger of this process of not being correctable. Oh, you guys stay with me now. Now listen. Watch this. He says, and Saul said, they have brought them from the Amalekites, and we saved the best, or they saved the best, to offer to your God in sacrifice. And the rest we utterly destroyed. Now it's we. Before it was I, then it was they and them, but the part that sounds like obedience, we did. Now I want you to see the little nuances that happen in your thinking when you're trying to get over. These are the little shifts and adjustments you make. When somebody confronts you on what you did and you say, that's not the way it went. And what's wrong with your voice? Why you got an attitude? Don't try to change the subject. See, that's that little nuance. You're going to try to shift it because you don't want to deal with what you're supposed to deal with. So we're going to make this an issue of the voice tone. This ain't an issue of the voice tone. Let's be clear. The voice tone is legit. God is mad. So his tone is mad. So you can't act like because it's a mad tone, you somehow victimized and got a legitimate defense. See, you don't understand. When Saul disobeyed, it set in motion the heavenly legal team See, when you violate the law, the prosecutor puts in motion offenses and launches a legal team who are designed to tear you apart. And once God enters this process, based on what Samuel's going to name in just a minute, the Bible says that he's blaming the people, and then he tries to take credit. So then Samuel said to Saul, stay. I like that. That's what your Bible say? Stay. In other words, Samuel been listening to this mess because Samuel got the true scope from God. And here's what's worse. Samuel has already tried to represent Saul to God, and God has told Samuel, I'm not having it. And now, Samuel, not only am I not having it from you, you got to go be my representative and not have it from him. I wish I could talk to you about leadership. See, leadership is not all glamorous. Leadership means you have to rebuke, you have to correct, you have to reprove. And the truth be told, people don't do what you expect, they do what you inspect. And you got to get used to the weight and the responsibility of confronting people. Watch this, even when you really want to cover them. I don't have enough time today. The Bible says that Samuel said unto Saul, stay, shut up. That's what he was literally saying. Stop talking. As soon as I came in the door, you start talking trash, stay. That's something you would say to Fido, stay. Be still. Stop playing with me, man. I had enough. And I will tell you what the Lord has said this night. And so Saul said, say on. I guess you're saying that now, ain't you? Say on. Samuel said, when you were little in your own sight, were you not made the head of the tribes of Israel? And the Lord anointed you king over Israel? Listen, Samuel, one of the things, and I need to say this to y'all, say it to myself, say it to all of us, one of the best solutions you can find is to remember what you were that God saved you from. Part of the intoxication of becoming power hungry and losing your mind is that you forget how far God brought you and you start assuming that you have a right to the place that you are. Samuel starts off, remember, you weren't just little in somebody else's sight. You were little in your sight. Do you remember there was a day when you couldn't see yourself doing what you're doing? You couldn't figure it out. You could not cast a vision. Matter of fact, you didn't even believe it could happen. But God. And he says, remember that? And he anointed you, he made you king over Israel and put you head over the tribes. The Lord sent you on a journey as a result of that anointing in that position. And he said, go, utterly destroy the sinners, the Amalekites, and fight against them until they be consumed. Now, watch what he says. Now we're going to start getting down to the nitty gritty and I'm going to let you go. He says in verse 19, wherefore then did you not obey the voice of the Lord? Here's the deal, Saul. Now that I got your attention and you ain't gaming no more, why didn't you obey God? You came in talking about you obeyed him when I walked in the door. Why didn't you obey God? He says, now he puts it in perspective. He says, not only didn't you obey his voice, but you did fly upon the spoil. If you let Saul kick it, it looked like the people did it. But the truth is, you leaped on it like a vulture. You the one that wanted to be on it. And now you don't want to admit it. And I'm going to show you why. Now we're going to break it down. Let me do a psychoanalysis of your thought process. He says, Saul, you flew upon it and did evil in the sight of the Lord. Verse 20, Saul still resisting. Watch this. He says, I have obeyed the voice of the Lord. And I have gone the way which the Lord sent me. And I've brought Agag. Now, listen to me, y'all. Listen to me. As a pastor, it's been 10 years at this church. It's really been 25 years of ministry. Now, listen. I have learned the danger of arguing with God. You know what the problem is with arguing with God? Since he's sitting at an intimate table and nobody can see him, not even you, you can convince yourself you won the argument, that you're right. And every argument you win with God, you lose. Saul says, I did do what he said. Where's this mentality coming from? What are you talking about? I've gone the way that the Lord. So your interpretation is that you obeyed God? You know what scares me about the scriptures? The Pharisees taught the word. They taught that the Messiah was coming. They were the housekeepers and the gatekeepers of the prophetic word. And yet, when it showed up, they tried to kill it. And they felt right about persecuting the very thing they were promising. I wish I could talk to you. It is not hard to become religiously blind. It is not hard to get stuck in your religious system and then begin to force God to fit in your system instead of fitting yourself into his will. Saul thinks he's right. Saul thinks he's right. He says, all right, well, I did it. I don't care what you say, Samuel, Mr. Prophet. Then he says it again, verse 21, but the people took of the spoil and the sheep and the oxen and the chief of the things. Now watch this. He adds something he didn't say before, which should have been destroyed. What? Wait a minute. You admitting that it should have been destroyed? That ain't what you said at first. And now you're still trying to push that you did God's will, but now you're slowly coming around. Look at how thick his resistance is. Now, please don't be over accusatory of Saul, because you and I have the same struggle. You and I need to be convinced. We need to be persuaded. We need to be convicted. Sometimes God got to break a leg. Sometimes God got to pull the chair out from under you. He got to take a job before you, like the prodigal son, come to yourself. Now watch, and it's good to come to yourself. The Bible says in this passage that he said, well, yeah, it should have been destroyed, but they wanted to sacrifice it to the Lord your God. Samuel said, now let's get down to it. Has the Lord, watch this question. This is a critical question, Samuel. It's a critical question, Saul. Critical question to you and I today. Samuel said, does the Lord have as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as he has in obeying? Question, which does God prefer? Now listen, because he calls for offerings, but he calls for obedience. Does he have as much delight in offerings as he does in obedience? I don't think so. Now let me just help you out here. We got a campaign. We're trying to pay the church debt off. We're going to do it, and we're going to help other people and all that. And we got bills to pay, and you're going to have to give offerings until Jesus come back. I got to do it. You got to do it. We all got to do it. However, as a church, guess what? I would be remiss if I made you think that God cared more about your money than he does about your obedience. Oh, I wish I could talk to you. One of the biggest crimes in the church today is that it's about money. It is not about money. It is about obedience. If you give God a sacrifice out of obedience, then you get the points for the obedience and the sacrifice. The problem is he became greedy in the early part of his leadership. Can I tell you that if you obey God, God will give you the stuff? But what God wants to know is, can I trust you with the stuff? Abram, come here. Listen, this is what I want, Abram. I don't want your money. I don't want that. I already took all that. You gave that to me back in the past when I told you to leave your father. But now that you're mature, now that you're seasoned, I'm going to really test you. Give me your son. Give me your only son. Give me Isaac, the one I promised to you. You know what? I'm not going to take your son, but I want to see if you're willing to give him up. Can I tell you that God is going to test you? He's going to test you at every level. And he's going to try to see if you prefer him or the car. Do you prefer him or the money? Do you prefer him or the prestige? Do you prefer him or some particular thing? And what he's trying to push is that you will discover what you are really made of. You say, the church don't never want nobody to have nothing. That's not the message. God blessed Solomon with a kingdom. God blessed Solomon with wealth more than any man. God blessed his leaders with wealth. God blessed his people with wealth. That's not the issue. It ain't that you can't have it. It's because you're a believer that you need to submit it to the Lord. Is he the center of your life? I don't really want your money. Matter of fact, God even only asked you for a tenth. So he ain't, the government wants 30%+. It ain't us. And it's all those advertisers. pastors that really want your money. What we want, what the Lord wants, is your heart. We want you to love God with all your heart, all your mind, all your soul. Obey him Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. Obey him on a good day. Obey him on a bad day. Obey him when it makes sense, and obey him when it doesn't make sense. Oh, I wish I could talk to you. This guarantees you the presence and the promise. Now, here you have a king who was anointed by God, and suddenly he's on the outs. Let's wrap this up. The Bible says, but the people took of the spoil, and so he blames them. Saul said, which is it? Which is it, man? Does God prefer your sacrifice, or does he prefer your obedience? And then he answers his own question. He answers his own rhetorical question. He says, for rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft. Rebellion, Saul. Now, Saul, I'm getting to it. This is what it's really all about. This is about your rebellion. And your rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft. What does that mean? You're a king. I've appointed you. I've anointed you. My intention was that you become a wellspring, and out of you becomes a flavor of water, a joy. If you're going to be a pastor cannot be violent, cannot be an aggressor, has to be hospitable, must have his house under control. Why? Because I want that spirit that's in your life to become the spirit that's in that church. You're my king. I don't want you demonstrating rebellion and witchcraft, because you will give a green light for everybody that comes under you to be rebellious, and you will give demons access. He says, Saul, rebellion is as witchcraft. Witchcraft, Greek word, pharmakia, mixing of potions. Rebellion, crack. You see what crack do? You see what it does? You see what drugs do? It's rebellion. You see what drugs do to the legal drug industry? You see how it makes doctors corrupt? You see how people want it so bad that they'll do anything to get it? You see how kids can take their parents' pills enough to get high and sell them in school? Because there is a spirit behind the mixing of potions that are designed to alter human behavior. And as a result, that spirit needs rebellion as a conduit. So every time I can find a rebellious person, I can multiply the activity of sin and iniquity and witchcraft. Matter of fact, if I'm Satan and I've got scouts scouting the neighborhood, I'm looking for rebellion in somebody's spirit. And if I can find somebody rebellious, I can release a legion of demons, because they will maximize their poison. And Saul, you're my king. I can't have pastors sleeping with the women. I can't have pastors taking the money. I can't have pastors on an ego trip. I can't have leaders polluting and poisoning from the very place where they declare the word of God. Because it is a place that should be hedged in, so that demons and spirits are kept at bay. And when you come in here, you can let your hair down and your soul gets healed and your prostitution gets clean and your drug addiction gets overpowered. But if you come in here and we got the same demons in here, from the top, what's the application? The application is me, my leaders, my elders. You got to keep it in check. You got to keep it in check. The staff, the deacons, the officers, you got to keep it in check. You got to be careful that you haven't gotten so comfortable with your office, with your title, with your position, that you start doing whatever you want to do, that you start assuming rights that you don't have, that you start trying to take territory that does not belong to you. From top to bottom. The Bible says, not only is rebellion as witchcraft, but stubbornness. Here's your team. Here's your twins. Rebellion and stubbornness. Stubbornness is as iniquity. Iniquity. You know what iniquity is? Iniquity is sin that spins a web. In other words, it's sin that coils you. You get entangled by the coils of your own sin. It's sin that ties you down. And when you want to fly, you can't fly because you've tangled yourself, locked and balled and chained to some sinful pattern, some behavior. That's why the Hebrew writer said, lay aside every sin and every weight that does so easily beset you. Notice, it easily besets you. God call you, and all that sin got to do is snap his finger, and you're trapped and you're stuck. And before you know it, you're stuck in a web. of iniquity. Stubbornness. Now, here's the deal. Because you're stubborn, when people confront you, you act like ain't nothing wrong. You stubborn. You got a what the Bible calls a stiff neck. Y'all remember we did that test before? Listen, we're going to do that test right now. Everybody, look at the person next to you. Now, do like this. Just push their head. All right? Now watch this. Now watch this. Stiffen your neck. Now push their head. That's a stiff neck. That's a stiff neck right there. Now notice how much energy it took. You're consciously resisting. You're determined. You ain't gonna move me. I ain't listening to you. I ain't changing. And what you doing touching me in the first place? Because you have practiced the pattern of stubbornness. And stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry. Iniquity is sin that ties you up, and it's idolatry. The reason it's idolatry is the reason you're being stubborn is because little bit known to you or conscious to you, you have erected some other priority, some other God in the place that God belongs. And whenever anybody tries to address it, you stiffen up your neck with your stubbornness, and nobody can't tell you nothing. That's why when Samuel said, "What's this sheep I hear in the background?" Saul said, "It wasn't me, it was the people. It wasn't me because I'm a stiff neck." Jesus saved me from the streets, from crime, from activity in the dark. And I'm familiar with demons, and I'm familiar with evil, and I'm familiar with the things that rip off people's life. And I didn't think I was going to be nothing. But when Jesus saved me, he said, "I'm going to give you a contrary message to your experience." And so I have a passion, and that passion is to see people free. I do not need anybody in a leadership position putting people in bondage in my church. This church is not designed to hold you down. It's designed to set you free so that you can mount up with the wings of eagles and live a life that is guaranteed success. Oh, I wish I could talk to you. And so therefore, I got to keep me in check. I got to keep me in check. Can't get puffy. Can't get arrogant. Can't stop making assumptions. I got to be willing to submit, willing to be challenged, willing to change, willing to grow. But I've learned over 25 years that every time I submit, God rewards. Every time I conform, God rewards. Every time you deny yourself, God fights your battles for you. And on the other side, afterward, it yields the peaceable fruit of righteousness. Listen to me, y'all. God has blessed us. You got doctors, you got lawyers, you got executives, you got business owners, you got entrepreneurs, you got creative energy. If you just take a look at the young people, just that one little instant of Diamond doing her thing wakes up a spark in somebody else. I'm here to tell you, I want young people on the instruments, young people on the leadership, young people handling the money, young people figuring out how to live, young people asking the hard questions, young people learning about stock. I don't just want them learning how to dance down the aisle. I got too many people that know how to dance down the aisle but don't know how to control their life. What I'm talking about is empowering people to live on the planet with authority. And so as it seems, as time comes around, we need to do an internal check. We need to do an in-house assessment. We need to do spring cleaning. Any rebellion in the ranks, any stubbornness in the ranks, come check me out as well. Bishop, you've been stubborn. You've been off the mark. You ain't been here. You lost out on this, or your absence while you've been working on your PhD has given place to this. Well, I don't want you scared to tell me that. I need you to come tell me that so I can say I was wrong and let me fix it so we can get back on track. Clear the air. This is my Father's house. It ought to be a house of praise, a house of prayer. It ought to be a place where nobody's become somebody's. It ought to be a place where lost folk get found. It ought to be a place where those who have been strengthened use their strength to strengthen others. It ought to be a place where everybody in the body is somebody, where there's no big eyes and little U's, where everybody that comes in here can drink of the Spirit of Almighty God freely. says your rebellion is as witchcraft and your stubbornness is as iniquity. And because, watch this, because you have rejected the word of the Lord has rejected you from being king. Now, just a couple nuances. First of all, let's do a mathematical equation. Rebellion plus stubbornness equal rejection. Did you get that? Did you get that? So if you want to persist in rebellion, you want to persist in stubbornness, God has a scientific formula. Rebellion unchecked plus stubbornness maintained equals rejection by the Father. Now, watch the text very carefully and don't miss the sleight of hand. He did not say, I reject you. He said, I reject you from being king. So you don't get it. When you want to fight against God, God can fight you in ways you can't fathom. So what happens next? He takes the kingdom. We already saw how God anointed David. He sent him to anoint David. And when the Spirit came on David, the Holy Ghost came off of Saul and a demon came on Saul. But when Saul got the kingdom taken from him, God did not remove him from the position. Tell me how miserable it is being in a place that God put you, but the God that put you there walks away from you. So you got a badge, but you ain't got no gun. And you can't leave the position because he gonna bring David, and David is gonna take 10 years as a soldier to become a mighty man. Then Saul gonna chase him for 6 years. So for 16 years, he's got the throne, but he's got no power. I don't want to live like that. I don't want to be up here preaching and the word does nothing for me, but he blesses it 1 foot from my mouth. Remember, why is God chasing him? God wants righteousness. Is he going to get it from Saul? No, Saul's level of rebellion is too extreme. So what happens is Saul, instead of repenting, he fakes repentance. And he says, come out with me before the people and make me look good. And he doesn't do it. See, everything you say is this is what I learned. I learned this. You better be careful what you say to God. Remember Pharaoh? Pharaoh was talking trash. After being whooped up by God, it was a war of the gods. 10 plagues later, Pharaoh's still talking trash. He looked at Moses and he said, you will not see my face again. Moses said, you said it. God gonna do what you said. See, when you start talking trash, you need to be careful, because Saul was talking trash. He said, come honor me, come honor me. And the prophet said, no, I'm not going out to honor you. You've rejected the word. God has rejected you from being king. And he stood his ground, and Saul was still stubborn and still fronting. But then he became desperate because the prophet dropped his bomb, and once he was done, he turned to walk away. In desperation, Saul reached out and grabbed his garment. His garment ripped. And if you ever meet a real prophet, a prophet is a visual thinker. A prophet uses real situations as analogies to give you a portrait of what God's about to do. And when Saul ripped the kingdom, the prophet turned around, looked at his garment, and says, as you have ripped this garment, the Lord has ripped the kingdom from you. Not only is he going to take it, before he might have been willing to take it and be gracious, but now he's going to take it and rip it, and he's going to give it to your neighbor. Did you hear that? Your neighbor. He's not going to give it to somebody you don't know. He's going to give it to your neighbor. And then he says, someone who is better than you. Now watch this. Watch the danger. I'm convinced of something. Listen to me, y'all. I'm going to go extreme on you. I'm convinced that hell is not the final solution to give you righteousness. Because the rich man and Lazarus. Lazarus winds up in Abraham's bosom. The rich man is in hell. What does he say in hell? Father Abraham, which means you knew who he was, send Lazarus to give me a drop of water. First of all, you still tripping. You in hell, Lazarus in heaven. And you still think you can command him. And then you ask him some dumb stuff. Send him with a drop. You in hell. It's going to evaporate by the time you, can I get a H? I wish I could talk to you. I hope you get in. You in hell and you still arrogant. You still think Lazarus is your servant. You still think they serving you, which means hell did not solve your arrogance. You better work on your arrogance now. You better address it now. You better deal with your stubbornness now. You better deal with your rebellion. And don't look at me like, Bishop, I'm glad you telling them. You know this is for you. The Lord, he's also rejected you from being king. And Saul said to Samuel, I have sinned. Look at, for I have transgressed the commandment of the Lord and of thy words. It sounds good, Saul, but you're fronting. And I feared the people. You're getting close. You're telling a little more. You feared the people. You obeyed their voice. Now, therefore, I pray thee, pardon my sin and turn again with me that I may worship the Lord. And Samuel said, no, I'm not going with you because you rejected the word. And now God has rejected you from being king. I'm not being a part of your scheme anymore. And Samuel said unto him, the Lord has torn the kingdom of Israel from you this day. Now watch this, y'all. Watch this. And I'm done. I got to go. He says, and he has given it. Those terms are past tense. Listen to me. Listen to the warning why rebellion is not worth it. Samson, what's going on? Everything fine. What you doing? Laying with harlots? Well, and then the problem, doesn't this violate your Nazirite vow? Yeah, but it's cool. I'm cool. Every time I do it, I don't see no lightning bolts. Everything's cool. Doesn't look like nothing's wrong. I think I'm getting over and everything's smooth. Yeah, but here's the problem. You don't know when God's going to retract. Yeah, but I've been doing it a while. I've been getting over. It's kind of smooth. Look to me like his grace is sufficient. And you know, my spirit is willing, but my flesh is weak. And you know, he got verses in there just for me so I can do both and I can be on both sides. Well, wait a minute. So what's going on? Tell me how it worked out. Well, here's how it worked out. Well, first she said, to show me your strength. So I said, okay, if you tie me up with new ropes. And she tied me up and I broke out. And then I told her if she tied me up with green whips. And then I told her if she'd do this. And then I told her she'd do this. And she kept on digging at me. So she got closer. So I told her if she put my hair in a bun. And she put my hair in a bun, but I broke out. And then she really got to me one day. And so I told her, well, I tell you what, if he cut my hair. And the Bible says she cut his hair because he laid in her lap. Can you stop laying in sin's lap? Can you stop laying in the wrong place and putting your investment where it should not be and spending your anointed marbles in the wrong places? Because eventually you're going to lay down one too many times. And when he did, the Bible says she cut his hair. Got the Philistines in place. And then she said, like at other times, Samson, the Philistines are upon you. First of all, why are you playing with somebody that keeps playing around with the Philistines anyway? And so she said, the Philistines are upon you. And he jumped up and said, no problem. I will, as at other times, rise up and take them out. But that verse says, at the end of chapter 15 in the book of Judges, or chapter 17, it says, but he did not know that the Spirit of the Lord had departed from him. You can control your sin, but you cannot control your consequence. The way you control yourself is you let God have a path to rebuke you, to correct you. As quiet as it's kept, you want to know my secret for 25 years? It's putting myself in positions where I'm accountable. If it's school, I got to do homework. I got to meet a deadline. I got more stuff. Sometimes you need so much stuff that you ain't got time to do nothing stupid. You need to fill your calendar with responsibility. Let me tell you something. You stay in front of TV. You're on video games. You watch TV. You're on the phone with the wrong people. You listen to the wrong music. You hang out at the wrong places. It's just a matter of time for something wrong to happen. There is enough life to be lived in the Lord where you involve yourself. Get out your mind. I go to church every Sunday for 2 hours. That's it. That's the only exposure you have is 2 hours. Are you kidding me? It's 24 hours in a day and 7 days in a week. you have to submit yourself to processes. I know right away, people come say, I want to serve, I want to do this, and then they rebel against the first thing you give them. I ain't got no time for that. The first thing you tell them to do.
Who you think you are?
I think I ain't got nothing for you to do. That's what I think. And I ain't gonna tell you that. I'm just gonna say, hey, how you doing? God bless you. Rebellion, sin of witchcraft, stubbornness. God says to him, Saul, he's giving it to your neighbor. When you are already scheming and getting over mentality, and then God rejects you and disciplines you and says something like, and that's the problem with prophets. Prophets tell you more information than you want. He gonna give it to who? A neighbor. So now guess what Saul is doing? He don't trust nobody. So not only are you miserable, the Holy Ghost is gone, you got demons accompany you every day, the kingdom is falling apart, there's anarchy in the people because there's anarchy in your heart, there's a spirit of confusion, you can't win a battle, the prophet ain't showing up, and now you don't trust nobody. You are living a miserable life. All because on your first campaign, you chose not to obey God, but to chase the best stuff. What am I saying? God corrects us to keep us right. Now listen to me, y'all. Everybody ain't gonna be no millionaire. Can that be okay? Can it be okay to live a life making a certain amount of money? Yes. The fabric of life has never been that 100% of the population is millionaires. Jesus even said, the poor you have with you always. Now, if Jesus said it, what does that mean? It's always going to be somebody poor. Now, I know you don't want that. That's not your life. I ain't never heard nobody say that's my life verse. My life verse is, the poor you have with you always. I understand. I understand. I ain't never heard nobody say that. And if you said it, I really won't talk to you because there's some other verses you can be choosing now. So, but the point of the matter is you must learn to accept your measure. People would come to me all the time, especially when we was on TV. Oh, you the next T.D. Jakes. No, I ain't. I mean, I understand the compliment. Thank you for believing in me. But let me not let that mess get in my spirit. I ain't trying to be the next T.D. Jakes. Maybe God don't want me to have that much influence. Maybe I would mess up if I had that much influence. Maybe I better figure out what my range is and the measure of my ministry and be 100% faithful with that and not be mad at God for giving me more than I... Oh, I wish I could talk to you. If you can balance these principles today and address this rebellious tendency and let God correct you, I promise you that you will see things in life fall in line. You will see things that you cannot control work to your benefit. Does that mean you're going to escape trial? Of course not. Remember, if you bear fruit, he's going to prune you so you can bear fruit. More fruit. But I want you to understand this. No chastisement seems joyous for the present, but afterward it yields the peaceable fruit of righteousness. You say, well, Bishop, the story breaks down because Saul didn't really come around to repentance. No, he didn't. Saul went the other way. Saul killed the priest trying to catch David. Saul spent years chasing David. Saul tore the kingdom apart. They were so glad to have David when his time came because Saul had created such anarchy. Amen. I just dropped this in. I believe God has Sauls for churches who are rebellious today. Just so that you get so frustrated enough that you're willing now. What is it you want, God? But my point is, God's program did continue and did yield the peaceable fruit of righteousness because he disciplined Saul publicly so that the nation saw God. The nation saw God address a rebellious king and a rebellious people, and then saw God continue his kingdom agenda through David. Now, if you want my advice, and you got to go through this rebellious and stubborn thing, here's my rule. One day. I can stay mad for one day. I can have attitude for one day, maximum. I'll be shooting for 3 hours. Because that nastiness in your spirit kills you. So I have developed a system. One day. And that's a maximum. If I get mad at my wife and I'm really mad at her and it take a whole day, then that's it. The next day, I love her. You get in trouble letting that stuff linger. You be all mad for 2 weeks and the devil send all these people by. What you mad about, honey? Oh, yeah, I'm just so mad. I don't know what to do. You better solve that stuff. I'm mad enough that this feels right. You better go watch Fatal Attraction. Give you a little reminder. Old movie with a good message. Leave that nut alone. What do you mean? Who's the nut? Anybody you ain't married to is the nut.